It's a minute gone already, so I have to hurry up. What crisis are we talking about? Are you in a crisis? Are you hungry? I hope not. Are you in need of water? What's going on with all of you? Did you eat this morning? Are you in immediate danger? I don't think so. You all look pretty comfortable to me. So how can we change our behavior to make a change in the world? Because the planet will survive, you know. The planet will not go away. The planet will last for another 7 to 8 billion years. That's one theory. And what about human beings? Human beings will last for 10,000 more years. One theory, at least, of a person named Carter. And another theory is it lasts for 7.8 million years, which is much better. It's a theory by Gott. Richard Gott, double T, I'm sorry. So we care for our children, don't we? We care for the next race. We care for the coming years. We care for our neighbors, etc., etc. But when the human race is gone, and I've always thought about what will happen to the planet, when the human race is gone, it will take 1 more million years before all the buildings are gone. And then it's empty. And nobody will remember us ever anymore. Can you imagine that? We're the moon, something like that. Or Mars. And that is so, to me, so scary, actually. But on the other hand, it's also comforting, maybe. You know, we care, as I said, for others. And we have cared for quite a long time. We have cared actually all the time that human beings have been on the planet for each other. However, we have never made it into a science. And that started about, let's say, 150 years ago. When we started to make this, and we started to talk about ecosystems, the word that you probably know, and we started to talk about pollution. And before pollution, we started to talk about cutting all the forest, and we created something that we called the Sierra Club. And this was about 125 years ago. So we started to create clubs. There was a famous woman that probably none of you have ever heard of, and her name was Rachel Carson. And Rachel Carson wrote this famous book, Silent Spring. And she started to talk about something that I hope you have heard of. It's called DDT. And DDT is poison. And we put the poison on the land so we have more food. That doesn't sound very intelligent, does it? And then she started to create something which is now called the EPA, Environment Protection Agency. So this was 125 years ago. Then 50 years ago, you all know, I hope, that in Rome, a club of intellectuals came together and they started to talk about the planet and how they could save it. So when they met, they found out, actually, that they didn't know so well what to talk about. So they postponed their meeting until a year later, and they came back. And in the meantime, they did a study, wrote a book, and that book is very famous, called Limits to Growth. Grenzen aan de groei. How would that sound to Trump? Grenzen aan de groei. Horrible, but also the title, Limits to Growth, was a very famous book. It was sold in the Netherlands, which was very small, only 13 million people. It was sold 900,000 copies. Can you imagine that? Do you know the average management book, how many copies are sold? 500. Well, don't buy management books, I would say. 900,000. So I calculated that everybody between 40 and 50 years old at that time read the book. So what happened? Nothing. Nothing happened. So then we go on about the Club of Rome, which is a club still existing of highly intellectual people. And you can become a member of it, by the way. Also the Sierra Club, you can become a member. And then later, again, a club started to be founded, which is the most fun team of people, entrepreneurs. Social Venture Network was founded 30 years ago, actually 31 years ago, by Ben Cohen. Ben Cohen, you know, all know Ben Cohen because he founded Ben & Jerry's. You know Ben & Jerry's ice cream. And he is a very nice old activist. You should see him speak, the energy that he gives. Man, it is overwhelming. So he founded Social Venture Network, which is a club of entrepreneurs. And those entrepreneurs thought that they should build a company that had a purpose. Can you imagine that? A company with a purpose. Can you imagine that you would ever work for a company that has no purpose? Most companies are like that, unfortunately. That you sit in your car or your bicycle, you go home, and you thought this was a great day again for useless business. 70% of all the people on the planet, well, let's stick to Maastricht. All the people in Maastricht who work don't like their jobs. Can you imagine that? What a happy planet we have. 70% of the people don't like it. So those social venture network guys, I'd make a step further, they create a great bunch of guys, hippies. In the year 2000, because I have to go through the time, that's what we call time lapse, you know. The United Nations, which is a pretty boring institution, but great, created the Millennium Goals. Who has heard of the Millennium Goals? All of you. Unbelievable, because, well, all of you, I would guess 20%. So that is already phenomenal, because normally when I do speeches and I say, who of you have heard of it, one hand maybe or two. So people don't know what it means. But it is so high in the sky, the Millennium Goals, that companies and people don't know what to do with it. It is too big. But what it shows is that when we talk about sustainability, we have to talk in a holistic way. Sometimes people say, I have an electrical car, or some people say, I have waste management, and plastics are here, and that is, well, you know, that is not sustainability. That is normal. That is normal. That is hygiene. So, but sustainability goes much further. How do you treat your people? Next phase, 2006, a new kind of company was created called B Corps. And B Corps are what they call the Champions League of sustainability. When you want to create a company, it should be a B Corp. Because the B Corps are companies like Ben & Jerry's, Kickstarter, Patagonia, Triodos Bank, you know some of them on the list here, that really think about how they can divide the profit and how they will not be a company only for the shareholders, but also for the stakeholders. Then 2015, the United Nations thought, let's do a next step. So they created 17 sustainable development goals, very important. Again, some of them are a little bit the same than the Millennium Goals. And now this goal is what we have to reach per 2030. 30. So it's far away. And again, as you can see, who can be against those things? So what do we need to start moving? In the Netherlands, we have a saying that goes, als de wal het schip keert. Are there any Dutch people in the audience? Oh, some. Okay, so I try to translate it, when the wall turns the ship, that would be horrible, you know, as a translation. So it is, when the shit hits the fan. When the shit hits the fan, it happened to Els. The shit hit the fan. And when the shit, and you see the shit behind me, and the shit behind me is what we call externalities. And externalities are shitty things that happen and that you all have to pay for. Congratulations. And not the companies who make a profit. Let me give you one example. In Groningen, we have this thing. We pumped gas up. Some of you maybe have heard of it. We pumped the gas up, and then the houses started to fall. Well, we could have known that on beforehand. Hey, come on. Are we crazy or what? So the houses started to tumble. Huh? Who is paying for that? Well, the profit goes to the people who pump the gas, and the cost goes to you. That is a great externality. Are you happy with that? Good. Then you have many more externalities. And that is the crisis that we have. And that is what we don't see. Because why did we give 7 million to the tsunami people after the tsunami? Think about that. Because there was no shit on our fans. There was a shitty system. So it is so difficult to start, as you can see on this picture. And we need the entrepreneurs to start. The people like these people that are happy people, sometimes you recognize the people. I always talk about the survival of the happiest. Companies where people smile, where people are happy, that give energy, you know. Everybody is standing on this dot, I don't know why that is. I'm going to stand here. It's kind of scary. It's too big. Now I have to walk around it a little bit, and because I don't know what it's for, it is intimidating. You know, it's the contrary of the survival of the fit, the happiest. Well, let me do this for the camera people. We need people with passion and perseverance who don't stop. So I will take you quickly through some of the sustainable development goals. One, because there are 17, it's way too many, you can look them up on Google. Heard of that? Google, they have a website called google.com. So you can look it up. And SDG number 6 talks about clean water and sanitation. You think we don't have enough water. Well, that is not the problem. We have enough water. As a matter of fact, we almost have the same amount of water. Some people say exactly the same amount of water. I don't know how to measure that. Then we had, when we started, 70%, as you know, of the planet is covered by water, which we cannot drink. But fresh water is only 0.5%. 3.5 million people, of which 2.2 million children, die every year because the water is polluted. It is not cleaned. 5 billion people have no sewage system. It's part of the problem of the pollution, of course. It smells pretty bad. You, on average, use 3,400 liters of water per day. Not all of you together, but you, and you, and you, and me. And the rest is fine. Don't worry. Americans even use twice the amount of water on average. They must drink a lot of water, don't you think? It's also for all kinds of other things I found out. No, I have to go back, because two entrepreneurs I want to mention here, Bojan and Anna. Bojan, some of you know, because he's a hero. He fights the plastic soup. And Anna is also a hero, both under 30, both award-winning entrepreneurs. And she produces stone paper. She has a company that produces the alternative to paper, which is one of the biggest polluting industries for water. So those two entrepreneurs are change makers. They're changing the world. Affordable and clean energy. We all know what happens with the energy transition in the Netherlands. We have some companies, as you can see there, Tesla, Solaris, companies that produce energy, people that produce energy. It's people, it is not the companies. There are small companies, my favorite company. SDG 8, Greyston Bakeries. Who knows Greyston Bakeries? Nobody? This is the greatest company, I would say, on the planet. Greyston Bakeries, founded by a Buddhist monk, was created to produce brownies. And I don't know how sustainable brownies are, but it was created to produce brownies. And the slogan is, we create a company. We hire people. We don't hire people to bake brownies. We bake brownies to hire people. Everybody can work there. They call that system open hiring. That means that every criminal, every drug, let's say, addict, can write his name or her name on the list and will be hired. It's the only place where people without any reference checking can start tomorrow. 40% only succeed, 60% fail. So people say to me, but Lane, 60% is pretty high of people failing in a job. I said, but 40% is more than zero. Those people cannot find a job anywhere else than there. It is a fantastic company. It is almost, and can you imagine what it feels when you walk around in that company, when you see those people? The company saved their lives. The products must be great, I always think. In the light of time, I showed you two more goals, 17. 17 is very, means that we have to cooperate, which is pretty logical. But I want to go from the past to the future. With the question, who inspires you? You, thank you. And that is, I pay you later. And that is, who inspires you? People who think about that don't normally give an answer because they think, oh, well, the difficult question that is. Oh, I have to put my priorities in the right order. Oh, I have 10 things that inspire me. But actually, it doesn't matter what you say. Every answer is fine. But the best answer would be, I inspire myself. Because you know, if you have a dream or a plan, or you have to swim to an island, you need energy, you inspire yourself. My first job was for Philips as an accountant. Can you imagine how boring that was? I hope you feel very bad for me. An accountant at Philips. Even at a prick clock, a clock that you have put a thing in and a ding, not a ding. Americans said, what is a prick clock? Well, it's a clock for pricks, of course, you know. So it is. And I was very tired after my 40-hour week of work. And then I stepped into my first own company. And I was never tired. I work every day, the whole day, and the weekends. So, but sometimes I hear this little voice in my head. The voice that you also hear. The voice that says, you can never do this. It will not succeed. Stop with it. Your singing is horrible. That voice. And if you now think, voice, what voice is he talking about? That's the voice. So you all have the voice in your head. But if you get over that, if you step over that voice, and you pick up your own passion, then it is you. You who is the entrepreneur. You are the beginning. You are the SDG even. It is you. It is your passion that will help us to survive. So, go for it!